might have started this thinking like I should take a 4 out because you know there it is, it's a 4. Took a 2, okay. Because while a 4 can come out of this one, this 4, right? No 4 there. But there's a 2. They can all have a 2 factored out. We can divide them all by 2. So you take the 2 out.
I did 2x and then just.
Okay, let's explore that. Let's explore that.
14.
Put an x there. And then parentheses. So we should have a 2.
X.
X plus.
3.
3 plus.
Plus 7.
Plus 7. Now what happens when I distribute this 2x? I get 4x squared. 6x. And 2x times 7 would be? 14x. But that doesn't have an x. So good thought. I mean, definitely take out an x if an x is there to factor out. But in this case, it's not. So this is just going to be 2x squared, x, and just the number 7. So 2 times 7 is 14. Good. Glad you brought it up. Otherwise, I would have had 2.
What would you do if they couldn't all be divided by 2?
Then there's nothing to do.
Then you quit.
The thing that I would be asking to do here is factor out the greatest common factor, and they just wouldn't have one. So you'd say, well, it's as factors as it can. Okay. All right. Let's try again. Try one more time. This is possibly the last time that it's going to be this easy. Try another time. Okay. So. Shelby's gonna write her factorization up there.
Okay, let me just find where I'm at here. Oh, there we are. Okay. Let's see if we can fit it right there.
We're going back to the back. They still are smart.
Good job, Shelby.
Okay, so, well, what kind of skills is Shelby exhibiting?
All of them.
Factorization.
All of
them. More skills.
No.
Wow. Just schooled you guys in some math.
Okay, factorization skills. It's good, you know, good opportunity to learn some vocab. If I were to multiply these together, like go from what you see in the second line back into the first line, I'd be multiplying.
Okay, put it in front of my skills.
Multiplying. Going this way, we're factoring. You guys have factored before, like 15 factored is 3 times 5. Because 3 times 5 is. Here are the factors of 3x squared plus 9x minus 15. The factors are 3 and x squared plus 3x minus 5. Those are the two factors of that thing right there. All right. We're working on our factoring skills.
Skills.
Now we notice. Dylan, especially.
I know. I don't know. I'm trying to figure out what the date is.
It's
the
9th.
9th?
Yes.
Look at me if you're right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sweet. All right. So I was just the way I was watching this. You divide all of these by 5, so you're gonna end up getting 5x.
Oh man, nice.
Something along those lines.
You're off to a good start.
It's legit.
let's also look at maybe at one point, or maybe right now, yours looks... I don't want to erase this. It's so let's just scoot it down. I'm going to assume that was... what was that?
It was the explosion, actually.
That was an explosion.
Yeah.
Now I feel silly.
Of course
not. So maybe yours looks like this, though. You just took a 5 out, which means this would be x cubed minus 4x squared plus 3x. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah, if I distribute the 5, will it not turn back into 5x cubed minus 20x squared plus 15x? It certainly will. But there's more that we can pull out.
It's the x.
More of it.
Yes.
Okay. We should all wind up with the same thing. Okay, if I factor it as much as possible, we should all get the same final answer. So what we have here, what Johnny's written down, is just the result of noticing, oh, there's also an x, not only in this term and this one, but also this one. So I can pull that x out. And now 5x times x squared, 5x cubed. 5x times negative 4x, negative 20x squared. And 5x times 3, 15x
equals shrink.
Right, so we're always looking for like the most, the biggest, most complicated term that we can divide out of each of these. That's what we're looking for. Let's see if we can figure that one out. What's the biggest, most complicated? What's the most that you can factor out of each of them? We got it. And so Ashlyn's going to show us. Perfect work. Saw that not only a 3 can be factored out of each of these, but also each of them has one factor of x. Okay? And each of them has one factor of y. So she takes out that factor of 3, x and y. Make sure that if she were to distribute, at least this is how I'm thinking when I do the factoring, not really dividing, or I don't feel like I'm dividing. I'm thinking, what do I have to multiply this by, right, or this by to get 12x to the fifth y squared? 3 times 4 is 12, x times x to the fourth is x to the fifth, and y times y is y squared. Okay. With the second one, we would need to multiply an x by an x to get x squared. 3 times 3 is 9. Y times 1 is y. And then look at that, that's that last term. Like it is made up of the factors that we can pull out of these two. So make sure you do have that minus 1, though, because you don't want to just leave it blank. That would be like putting a 0 there, and 3xy times 0 would have been nothing. That term wouldn't show back up if we had distributed the 3xy. So we distribute the 3xy to the negative 1, we get negative 3xy. These all have a 2 in common?
Yeah.
What?
They, even more than that, have what in common?
4.
4.
Yeah.
So go big. Go as big as you can. The greatest common factor. So we're looking for.
12.
Greatest common
6.
Factor. Okay. Is there anything bigger than 4? Like 6?
Nope.
6 because can come out of there, but not out of there.
Yeah.
What about 8?
8.
Well, it can't go into 12.
8 doesn't go into 12. So it looks like 4. I think we're kind of stuck with 4.
I don't know.
If you did two, what you'll find out is when you get done, everything that's left inside the parentheses, like if you look inside the parentheses you have, I bet all the things inside the parentheses also have a factor of two. Like still. Right?
Yeah.
So if I pull out another one, then I'll have a four inside.
Nine? Yeah,
because
I did two.
Oh, you did two. Well, two, that should take me down to six, 12, eight.
I want that.
16.
Oh, yeah, 16. Not 16. Okay, here we go. Pulling out a 4. Anything else?
X.
They all have an X. What about Y? Do they all have a Y?
No.
No, they don't.
Do they have more than one X?
Yes.
Just keep it one X.
Well, but one has just one. So.
Just X, yeah. The only X to the one. If this one had like an x squared, well then we can pull out an x squared because they all have an x squared in them.
No.
But that's not the case. So we pull out a 4x, and that leaves us with, right? We just got to think about redistributing this 4x and getting back what we had to start with. So what would this have to be? So the 4x times this is 12x to the fifth. 12x to the fourth. Plus what's next? Y, 4 times 6 is 24, x times x is x squared, and there's the y right there.
No, it'd just be y squared.
Just be 8y squared?
Yeah.
Just negative 8y
squared. Or either that, yeah, I didn't know how to write that, so I said x1, y2.
Well, this is x to the first.
Yeah.
And you just see it, x, it is x to the first. So I don't want an x to the first here, I want an x squared there.
Okay,
so that's what we call factoring out a monomial. Right? Remember polynomials, that's what these are. A monomial. Monomial, right? Has one term. We pull out the one term that they all have in common. So factoring out monomials.
They're all sick.
All right, so we all have those skills now. Okay. Now, in order to develop the next level skill, I want you to, quickly as you can, just multiply these four, right, four separate problems, four separate colors. They have each their own separate thing, so you don't have to like multiply all four of these together. Okay. It's a bit crazy. So just the blue ones, red ones together, orange ones, green ones together. Okay, so I'm going to multiply these together with you quickly and using the path that we talked about that I think is most helpful when we try to reverse this whole thing. Okay, so what I think is most helpful, what makes this next skill easiest to pick up, is if we think of it as x times x, distribute the x to the negative 8, 2 times the x, 2 times the negative 8. Arches. If you're distributing the parentheses to the x and to the negative 8, like that's, I feel like it's even more correct. But you may want to pick up this little trick, or you may not. Maybe it'll gel with you just fine. The thing to recognize is we're going to wind up with x squared minus 8x plus 2x minus 16. Even if you do the double distribution, you wind up with that. And then we combine the negative 8x and the 2x, and we wind up with x squared minus 6x minus 16. And remember, what we're trying to learn now is how to reverse from x squared minus 6x minus 16 back up to knowing that that came from x plus 2 times x minus 8. Okay? So watch as we multiply these together, watch the consistent pattern that we see. And start to think, how would I know from just x squared minus 6x minus 16 that it came from x plus 2 times x minus 8? Right? So just think about that as we multiply these next three together. So x times x, x times 4. X squared plus 4x, and then 3 times x, 3 times 4, plus 3x plus 12.
Sorry.
So notice I already see the x squared, and I already see the 12 there. Like, the 3 and the 4 already tell me that I'm going to get 12 at the end, and just x times x, obviously, is x squared. But we combine the 4x and the 3x, right? And starting from there, how would you figure out that it came from x plus 3 times x plus 4? Keep thinking about that yourself. Let's do this one. X times x, x squared. X times 7, 7x. Negative 4 times x, negative 4x. Negative 4 times 7, negative 28. Combining those two together, x squared plus 3x minus 28. So again, notice the negative 28 that I see, even from the beginning, because this is going to be the new beginning of our problem, I already know that those two guys multiplied together to make negative 28. And obviously the x times the x give you the x squared. Okay.
I've got another one.
Mystery part is a little bit like, well, the mystery of it is it kind of in that middle term.
Okay, well, if you look at the original problem that we just did.
This one?
Yeah. Having done it so many times, I know that I'm going to end up with a 4x and a 7x.
And a negative 4x and a positive 7x.
And I'm
going to
combine those.
All right, and so you're just, in your head, without writing down this middle thing,
mm-hmm.
you just jump right to combine these two for 3x,
mm-hmm.
right? Do you see what she's saying?
Mm-hmm.
So Shelby, when she's multiplying, she just knows, without writing this down, she's going to have a negative 4x and a 7x. Just combine those numbers together, 7 and negative 4.
You've got your middle x.
You got your 3x. You see what that could be a handy thing to take note of. Okay? Let's try that. This is the last one. Okay. So we get x times x is x squared. We know we're going to get negative 1 times negative 1. Now what's negative 1 times negative 9?
Negative 9,
9
to 9.
Positive
9.
And so Shelby's saying to find our middle term, our x term, well, we're going to get a negative x and a negative 9x, so they're going to combine to make
negative 10x.
Yeah. Right? Now, as long as there's a just x and just x, like 1x and 1x, right? No problem. That works great. And that's where we're going to be working from today, where we have so 1x and a 1x. So basically, we know that there's going to be an x squared. If there's an x squared and not like a 2x squared or a 3x squared, you know you just multiply an x by an x. So you know that your parentheses have an x in the left one and an x in the right one.
You're going to get us to try to find a single monomial factorization of this?
No.
Okay, good.
I don't think you need that. I mean, sometimes you have to factor out a monomial and then factor in. Not today. Don't worry about that.
Okay.
I'll back up. Okay, so I'm going to give you something that's been multiplied out, and then you're going to figure out what two parentheses multiply together to make that. So let's start off fairly basic. X squared plus 5x plus 6. Try and figure out, right, it was, just to give you a hint. You know what it looked like? This, right? And then there was like a number here, and a number here, multiplied together to give you x squared plus 5x plus 6. Right? So don't give it away to anybody, just take it for yourself. Pick it up a little bit. All right, so what do you think? This is plus what then?
2.
2.
3. Minus 3.
Just kidding.
I was just checking.
Okay,
I realized my mistake.
Okay, let's think about that too. Here's. Oh, wow. Haley, you say 5 and 1?
Well, I don't know. I did 2 and 3.
Okay. Let's think about another possibility. Now, you know, how are we going to figure this out? There's lots of different strategies we could use, but here's what we'll take note of. We'll think about all the times we multiplied two parentheses together and all the patterns that came out of that, right? So let's look at this last number here, negative 16. Where'd that come from? Negative 8 times 2, negative 16. Let's look at the same last number here. Where did the 12 come from? Where did this negative 28 come from? 7. Where did this 9 come from?
-9 and -1.
So
that's how you get those.
So you know that these two numbers need to do what?
equals 6.
When you
multiply.
When you multiply them. 2 times 3, 6. What else times what else is 6?
3 times 2.
1 times 6.
1 times 6.
There you go.
Okay. But only one of these is going to work out because also notice. Notice that you have this middle term, but this middle term comes from negative 8x plus 2x, negative 6x. 3x plus 4x, 7x. 7x minus 4x, 3x. Negative 1x minus 9x, negative 10x. So those numbers need to multiply together to make to give you your last term, your constant term. But also we know in the process of multiplying those together, they would each get an x. We'd combine them together, and that'd be my final x term, right? So only this one will work. This one won't. Let's see what happens. X times x, that doesn't look like x times x. X times x, x squared. X times 3, 3x. 2 times x, 2x. I'm not putting any addition in there. 2 times 3, 6. So we get x squared and we get 6. Let's look at this one. X times x squared. X times 6, 6x. 1 times x, x. And 1 times 6 is the 6. They both wind up with an x squared on the left side, a 6 on the right side. But in the middle, only this one gives us x squared plus 5x plus 6, where this one gives us x squared plus 7x plus 6. All right. If we were listening to Shelby earlier, we could have seen quickly that it was going to happen because she noticed that this always gets an x and this gets an x. We add those together, 2 plus 3, 5x. Where this, 1 plus 6, 7x.
Woo.
So that's out. That's not it. This is our guy right here. This right here, this was just checking. That's not really part of an answer you would give. This is the answer. It's factored. Okay, Jason?
Never mind.
You were going to ask?
No, I figured out what
okay.
I was doing.
All right, you see how we're, what we're doing there? Factoring out just like that. Okay? Let me give you another one. Not that. X squared plus... 8x plus
15.
It was 8.
Right.
5
is
8.
Woo!
And 3 times 5 is 15. So you got it. I mean, if it multiplies to this final number and adds to this middle number,
oh,
you must have it.
Man, I wish I could have that.
You must have
Simon.
It.
But I couldn't.
No.
There's more to learn.
There's more to learn. You just wasted 7 seconds asking it out. X times x is x squared, x times 5 is 5x, 3x times 3 times x is 3x, and 3 times 5 is 15, so we know that we got it.
Alright,
so let's try another one. Let's throw some negatives.
Throw it out.
X squared plus, let's see, 2x minus 24. Why it's wrong. Let's try x plus 12, x plus 2. So why might I think that's right, but why is it actually wrong?
Because you need a subtraction from
it. Why would I need a subtraction from it?
Because you have a negative
24. It needs to multiply to negative 24. 12 times 2 is positive 24. Negative 24. So negative 2? So 12 times negative 2, negative 24, right?
Yeah,
that's
still
well, but there needs further investigation.
It needs 2, not 10.
Because what happens, we get x squared, of course, we get x squared, and of course we get minus 24. We know like the beginning and the ending are right, but in the middle we get 12x minus 2x, that's
10x.
I want 2x. Okay. So I know it's not 2 and, or 12 and negative 2. But I start to learn things. I learned that we're going to have like a positive x term and a negative x term. They're going to add together, and they need to be a 2x.
I did 6 and 4. 6 and negative 4.
6 and negative 4. Let's see. Well, x times x is going to be x squared. If we jump to the end of it, 6 times negative 4, negative 24. Let's look in the middle. 6 times x is 6x. So x times negative 4 is negative 4x. What's 6x minus 4x?
2x.
Mm-hmm.
So, with my checking done, I've checked to make sure that it does work. Here it is. That's what I'm looking for. There's the factored form of x squared plus 2x minus 24. So like I said, if you're not sure where to start, start somewhere, then multiply it together. I tried 12 and 2, right?
I did too.
But then I found out, Caitlin told me, well, that comes out with a positive 24. You need a negative 24, which means we need a positive times a negative, right?
Or negative times positive.
Or negative times positive. All right, let's try x squared minus, let's do, minus 14, no, minus, I'm trying to think here, minus 8x plus 12. So I know that I'm trying to build these two factors. So when I multiply them together, I get this x squared minus 8x plus 12. So here's an interesting thing. This number times this number needs to be a 12, but when I add them together, it needs to come out to be negative 8. How can I do that? How can I multiply to get a negative, or as a positive like this, and then add together to get a negative?
I use the middle school method.
What's a middle school method?
Oh.
Yeah, what is that?
I did. Like, you know how when we go and we're actually like using one number and we factor it out
factor
all
tree.
The multiples?
Yeah.
That's what I use.
So you use 12 and you went like 6 times 2?
Yeah, I first I did 3 and 4 and then
oh, and
I did
four.
2 and 6. And
3, 4, 2, and 2 like that?
Well, no, no. Well, I was doing them like that, but yes, I just
But
added.
You just did a different one.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're finding the factors of 12, and you're thinking, okay, it could be 3 times 4, it could be 2 times 6.
And I did 3 times 4 first, and then I started getting all jumped up, and I noticed it wasn't right, so I kept
looking at
the factors.
They weren't going to go together and make 8 in any way.
Yeah, and so I made just looked at the factors, and it explained everything.
So what about looking at this explained to you?
It showed me that negative 2 plus negative 6 is going to be negative 8.
Uh-huh.
And then positive, well, negative 2 times a negative 6 is going to be 12.
So it, the secret is, as Dylan said a second ago, both negative. Mm-hmm. Not positive and a negative, that would come out negative. Not two positives, because that's never going to add up to a negative. Both negatives, because a negative times a negative is a positive. You get the x squared. Negative 2 times negative 6 is our positive 12. Negative 2x minus 6x is our negative 8x.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, is it jiving with everybody, or is it even people behind here?
No.
Good?
I have homework.
Jason?
Yes.
I'm ready. Let's do it. Promotion.
Quit saying homework, because we have more to do here. Okay? All right, let's say you feel fine about that. Now, the reason, well, one of the big reasons why we're learning all this factoring stuff is so that we can solve equations. We're always going to solve equations in algebra. So here's an example of an equation that would be tricky to solve if I didn't have this idea of factoring. Now, for today, I'm not going to make you factor this and solve an equation like all in one problem, okay? But I will make you factor like we were at the beginning of class and solve an equation. So at the beginning of class, all we did was look and see what do they all have in common, right? We don't need to worry about the right side of the equation. What do these two have in common that we can factor out of both?
They have an x.
They have an x, so it would look like x times x plus 2 equals 0. Okay? And we're using that zero product property again, where something times something, a times b, equals 0. Right? This is like a, and this is like b. What do we know when a times b equals 0?
A or b or both has to be 0.
A equals 0 or b equals 0. Or perhaps both. Okay. So this is like the first thing, right? The thing on the left that's being multiplied, x could be 0. That's pretty clear, pretty obvious. If x were 0, then 0 times this parentheses would obviously be 0.
Proving it right.
Or the entire right parentheses could be 0. So that 0 times whatever x is would be also 0. So if x plus 2 was 0, subtract 2 on both sides, x would have to be negative 2. Okay. So if x is 0, clearly 0 times this would be 0. If x is negative 2, then negative 2 plus 2 makes this 0, which means we're multiplying by 0 again, which means we have to get 0. So it's key that the right side is equal to 0. If the right side is not 0, then we really don't have anything to work from. Okay. Let's try this one again. We'll do this one again together. What can we factor from both of these?
X.
Anything else?
And
2. If you do just factor the x, it'll work just fine. You'll be able to solve it. But we can pull the 2 out. So pull the 2x out. We got 2x plus 3. There's like the skill from the beginning of class. We're factoring out the 2x. So once again, there's a one thing. There's a second thing that's being multiplied together. We're multiplying these two things together and getting 0. So one of those things, this one, or this one, must be 0. And now we just solve both equations. Divided by 2, x is 0. For this one, we have to subtract 3 from both sides, divide by 2, and x is negative 3 halves. They are the two solutions, 0 or negative 3 halves. Does that make sense?
What's up with that last step? Like, what
which,
you,
from here to there?
Yeah, you're, well, no. I mean, like, the last two pairs.
From here to there?
Yeah, like, are you just proving that it could be either or for x?
I think the answer, if I understand your question, is yes. Like, I'm saying that, you know, this.
Okay.
If this times this is 0, one of them has to be 0. And so I'm showing if, you know, if this were equal to 0, then x would be 0. If this guy on the right was equal to 0, then x would have to be equal to negative 3 halves. Does that answer your question or no?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So seem real keen to begin your homework. So we'll go ahead and begin the homework.